Hey, welcome to Producer Review. I'm Jay Wenko, joined in the studio by our very own Kevin Eckert. We're actually going to take some time and give some recognition to producers that have been active here at CMN this year, Kevin, and I can't wait to take a look at just a few of them.
Neither can I. These are some of the good ones.
They are. Well, they're all good because they take effort and they take some planning, and as anyone who's produced public access programming or any video production for that matter knows, it's not as easy as waking up in the morning and deciding you're going to complete a video.
It's a lot of work, so especially when it's not your full-time job. You got to make time to do it.
That's for sure. You involved in the training that CMN provides, you see these people when they walk into our production certification series for the first time, perhaps even holding a camcorder, the first time using a post-production edit software like Final Cut Pro. What have you seen in terms of from beginning to end?
Everybody has a different style. Everybody learns differently, but we try to accommodate everyone in the classes. It's very inspiring to see what people can do. Some people come in with an idea of exactly what they wanted to do right from the beginning of the class, and then other people kind of develop that idea as they go on. And it's interesting to see how people come together and work on shows together and develop their ideas into something real and put it on television.
Yeah, that team aspect of it is kind of encouraging when you think about it, because it's bringing people together who are here for a common purpose but who never knew each other before they stepped in the door.
That's right. It's a good way to meet people, too.
Yeah. Well, why don't we take a few moments and recognize some of the producers that we've, in no particular order, assembled for our inaugural program of Producer Review.
Okay.
This producer's name is Ernie Misch, and Ernie joined us in, I think it was the winter of 2010, January he started. So he's completed 4 years of production at CMN, and production.
That's right. He's got 3 different programs on the air right now. He's very diligent.
The program that we're going to watch some excerpts from this time is Great Waters Wonderland, right?
Yes, it is. All right. This one is about Seamus the dog.
Seamus, if you're Irish.
I'm not, obviously.
Let's watch it.
I'm Ernie Misch, your host, and tonight we're very fortunate to have a guest who has been here before, an outdoorsman, Mr. Terry Drinkwine. Hi, Terry.
Nice to see you again, Ernie.
Welcome. And I see you have brought a faithful companion.
This is Seamus. This is my bud.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And what breed of dog is that?
Seamus is a Brittany. They used to be called Brittany Spaniels, but the Spaniel designation's been dropped by the AKC, and they're just known now as Brittanys.
Oh.
They're a pointing breed. They come in liver and white like Seamus is, and they orange and white is probably the most prevalent. Mm-hmm. You'll see more of those around. Hmm. And they also come in kind of a speckled concoction, which are the French Brittanys for the most part. But they're great hunters.
Are they?
Seamus isn't a particularly large specimen, but he's very adept for what he's been bred to do, and
sure.
He's got a great nose, and if he has any drawback at all, it's that he's got so much energy he doesn't want to quit.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
How did you ever develop this passion for hunting?
Well, hunting is something. I mean, it's part of the outdoors. I mean, I've always enjoyed being outdoors, fishing, and when I was a kid. I grew up in Highland Park, and there were a lot of people who had rabid dogs out there, and for some reason. But matter of fact, over at where the expressway is now at 6 Mile and Oakland, mm-hmm. There used to be a big field there, loaded with pheasants and loaded with rabbits, if you can believe that. And they used to take their dogs out there, and they'd let them chase the rabbits and the pheasants. And mm-hmm. As a kid, I'd go along with them, and I just kind of enjoyed that. And
I read in your column that I can read once a week about the Ostrich Society. What is the Ostrich Society?
You know, somebody, when I first got the idea to write about the Ostrich Society, after I did that, I'd get these emails from people, and a friend of mine emailed me, and he said, "Are you talking about a bunch of drunken army buddies? Are you talking about a bunch of cops? Are you talking about, some guys you grew up with, or are these guys derelicts or what?" And I said, "All of the above." The Ostrich Society it's a frame of mind of people that that love the outdoors. They love dogs. Bird dogs is their passion. They love to fly fish. They love to tie flies.
Mm-hmm.
They love to be out. They love the camaraderie, and they love two fingers of bourbon.
Our next door neighbor, this was like 25 years ago, was a duck hunter.
Mm-hmm.
And he would go hunting with his brother, or his brother-in-law. And he loved being in the swamps looking for those ducks.
Yeah.
Now, I always thought you'd hunted ducks out on a, like Saginaw Bay.
Well, you do. I mean, you can lay out a chute in Saginaw Bay and in Anchor Bay and Lake St. Clair. They do it in the ocean, along the coast, the migratory birds, but they also jump shoot them. I mean, there are people that'll float a river, like maybe the Jordan. You'll float a river in a boat and, it can't be under power or anything like that, but maybe you use a canoe or a float tube of some kind, and, you end up jump shooting them where they're, maybe you've got a little eddy that there's, a couple of small
flocks,
things like that.
Sure, mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you think he's smelled a bird?
I think he's ready to go home to get his nightly ration of ice cream.
I see.
He has, she who must be obeyed makes him a concoction of a banana and yogurt and freezes it.
Oh my gosh.
And
he recognizes the words.
He does that. He does that. He does that.
And I hope, I know I learned a lot, and I hope you have too, folks, about hunting, about breeding of dogs, and how they work a field for their owner, companion. I'm Ernie Misch for Great Waters Wonderland. I'll be seeing you some sunny day. Take care.
Thanks
for that. Yep.
Yeah, that's a great show. What an example. I mean, Ernie's been prolific in production. I mean, the guy puts out three shows, probably at least one to two a week, it seems.
Oh, yeah, very, very frequently.
And he probably couldn't do it without a crew like he has, not to mention his wife.
That's true. It's a team effort. Everybody does a lot of work on the Ernie shows.
His wife, Mill, took our class after Ernie finished up, and she's been an integral part of the crew.
Yeah, it's interesting to see as time goes on, people who work on the crew, maybe as a camera person temporarily, they get interested in learning the other parts of the production, and some of them have taken the class since then, or some of them have taken the class again just to learn the other parts of the production. Mm-hmm. They want to know how to do everything.
Some of the elements, I think, of Ernie as a host that are noteworthy are his preparation. I mean, he asks good questions. You know, his guests are really noteworthy experts in their field, usually. I mean, Terry Drinkwine he's a columnist in a newspaper. He's a hunting expert and fishing and knows about the outdoors. And Ernie asks good questions because he's asking
he's
questions.
He's done a lot of research.
Yeah. The guys that he has on his show, they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
I like the way he recognizes them as well. You know, he puts in there a lot of graphics that indicate what their background is. It's kind of
you can find out more information about them. Yep.
Yeah.
All the cutaways and footage, B-roll. He goes out and shoots his own B-roll and takes media from the guests, photographs that they've taken, videos that they've taken, and integrates all of those into the show. It's fun to watch.
And there's like practically no subject that I've seen that he's uncomfortable with. I mean, he's brought in everyone from divers to experts at Field and Stream and many others just to...
Oh, yeah, it's a big range.
Yeah. Well, he does a great job, and we're looking forward to a lot more programming from Ernie Misch in this next year coming.
Definitely.
So. Next up, Kevin?
Okay, next up we've got a Eunice Kiefer project called Bridget, The Story of a Miracle, about her granddaughter, Bridget, who was born premature, and her whole family's kind of journey through her being born into her being in good health, and their experience at the hospital, their experience, the entire family. She interviewed a lot of people from her family on both sides of the family. It's a very heartfelt, touching kind of thing to watch. It's one of my favorites.
Let's take a look at it.
Sure.
Kiefer, and this is a story about my little granddaughter, Bridget, who was born 3 months premature and weighed only 1.5 pounds at birth. It's a story about faith, hope, love, and determination. According to the March of Dimes, 1 in 8 babies in the United States is born too soon each year. Premature birth is a serious health problem. After such a dramatic beginning and spending 2.5 months in the NICU, Bridget is now a happy, vibrant 4-year-old.
The definition of a premature baby is any baby born before 37 weeks of completed gestation. So any baby born from 23 to 24 weeks up to just before 37 weeks would be considered premature babies. The majority of those babies born prematurely are born what we call late preterm, so between 34 and 36 weeks are actually when the bulk of premature babies are born. And looking by age group, less than that, in weeks, the more premature a baby is, those numbers are smaller. So for example, we see the least amount of premature babies in the 23, 24, 25 week range.
I noticed that she was very swollen. Her hands, her ankles, her face, she just did not look like herself. Clearly, there was something going on.
I was about 27 weeks pregnant, and they give me an ultrasound, and they discover that the baby was about 1 month behind in her weight. And they told me that I had something called preeclampsia, which I found out was just pregnancy-induced high blood pressure. Something I never heard of before.
This is called Kangaroo Care. It provides skin-to-skin contact between mom and baby.
So the NICU is a very unique place. It's different than any other place in the hospital because we're taking care of babies who, in an ideal situation, the right place for them to be most often would be still inside the mother's womb, if that were the best environment for them.
When you can walk away from your visit and know that she's in the best place possible, in the best hands possible, that's a good feeling as a grandparent.
First year was just a series of going to the doctors and checkups and eye exams and heart exams, and she did really well on everything.
You know, she had, you know, very few problems. The heart valve didn't close real soon like they were hoping for, but eventually that happened. Took a little bit of time. We were at the hospital one time and they were so excited. She had a bowel movement and it was just a little tiny dot on a gauze pad, which was what they were using for her diapers, was just a little gauze pad because she was so small.
I'm glad my parents, Clarence and Vera Slaughter, were able to meet this amazing little baby. My dad passed away when Bridget was 16 months old. And my mom, who had an incurable brain disease called PSP, passed away when Bridget was 20 months old.
She was able to be around for Vera and Clarence. And Ray Ray, my mom, still gets to enjoy her. So anybody who comes in contact with her is just amazed. I mean, I've had people say, you know, babies are adorable, but that Bridget, she's something else.
Now can I see that picture?
What do you have to say?
Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday, dear Daddy!
It's not my birthday.
I don't want to go to the playground, sir!
That's a great story. Very touching, and she put a lot of work into it and properly recognized a lot of people that helped out on that production, including yourself.
Yeah, she did a ton by herself. She learned, I mean, that was her first production. That's her first video production. That 30-minute documentary, it's amazing. She went back out and reshot things. She worked very, very hard on that. It was really incredible to see.
Not all productions are flawless. You hit your bumps in the road, and she did.
That's
and
true.
And yet she came back fighting, and she had her goal in sight and kept going throughout.
Exactly. And, yeah, that was another example where we were able to integrate all this other media that people had taken, you know, cell phone videos, cell phone pictures and stuff like that. And, you know, with Final Cut 10, you can take all that stuff and assemble it all into the same timeline, and it works out perfectly. So that's a
documentary,
real benefit.
Documentary is not an easy project.
No, not at all, especially for a first project. Yeah. And she's done several other projects with her friend Holly since then, which have also been very good. Great B-roll, great exposition, really good work.
I think Eunice was a graduate of the Spring 2012 series of the production certification series.
So
hats off to Eunice.
Yeah.
Our next producer that we'll recognize is Paula Messner. Paula is from Royal Oak.
Yep.
And she put together a very nice effort on a remote production, van shoot, as we used to call it, but it's of course now a truck shoot.
Yep.
Down at the farmer's market in Royal Oak. She planned extensively for this because it was a public event. She needed several camera operators. She knew she was going to do interviews and covering a live event. Again, not so easy.
Definitely. Yes, and this was another example where it wasn't even just inside of this building. It was CMN plus another group working together to make a really great event that a lot of people got to enjoy.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, the bestest concert ever from Royal Oak's Farmers Market. Let's watch some of that right now.
Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
I can't hear you! Playing for the... Is this the first time with an orchestra?
No.
This is the second time with an orchestra, but they've been all over the world. Washington, D.C., Chicago, Grand Rapids. Their world tour includes one country, this one right here, but playing for the first time with the Royal Oak High School Orchestra. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the Candy Band!
Monsters live in holes, so their friends are little moles. They have parties all the time, and they drink a lot of slime. Monsters eat a lot, and they like their food real hot. They don't wanna eat your nose, they just wanna kiss your toe. Monsters! 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 Monsters!
A vacuum must always be created when the hands and the drums finally get mated. Scientists must try to consider why this beat is getting bigger and bigger. Party people! Hanging out in my basement. Guitar and drums going to pound and pound. It takes a party to pay my rent, you know. It takes a beat to make the sound. Somebody call the babysitter. 'Cause this beat's getting bigger and bigger. Scientists better try to consider why this beat's getting bigger and bigger. I'm just talking stuff, but it's legit. Used to do a lot of jello, then I had to quit. I like girls and parties and rhymes, like them loud guitars, and my drummer's got time. I had a New York blonde with a Detroit brain. We're living life in the fast lane, fast lane. Party people, they're hanging in my basement. It took a party just to pay my rent, yeah. Somebody call the babysitter.
Hi, we're here with the Candy Band, and Royal Oak knows them very well. Anita, Tammy, Paula, and Danielle, you guys sounded great. How do you think it went out there?
It was fun. We had a good crowd. Kids were dancing, so.
Now, your kids are all getting a little bit older. Are they here today?
They are here. My daughter Charlotte played with the orchestra with us, so I finally got to jam with my daughter, which is awesome.
All right, so you performed at the farmer's market before. Tammy, is your family here supporting you?
My daughter's here in the hair and makeup department. And my husband's here, and mother-in-law, and a couple of in-laws. So, yes, I've got a good crowd today.
Yeah, there's a lot going on, and none of you have crazy makeup or purple hair or anything that over there at the makeup station. So, what's in store for the Candy Band?
Well, we got a bunch of summer shows booked. We'll kind of be all around Ann Arbor, I think, for the first time. We played their library, but now we're playing a festival in Ann Arbor. Novi, I'm sure we'll be in Royal Oak at some point. The zoo, yeah, the zoo.
If you want to get your own mustache, because as you can see, I am celebrating Mustache March right now, and you too can celebrate right here with the Optimist. The Royal Oak Optimists are making mustaches on everybody.
Do one up for them.
This is a little kind of Charlie Chaplin-esque, yeah. You think? Yeah?
We'll pick your color. Oh, this is good. This
is like Groucho Marx. There we go. This is good. How do I look?
If you want to get completely dressed up, made over, photo and the whole thing, we have our makeup and hairdo and photo booth right over there. Go do that.
All right, I'm here talking with Lucas at the Musical Petting Zoo. Hey, Lucas, how you doing?
Good, how are you doing?
Oh, good, thank you for asking. So, could you tell us a little bit about what's going on today?
Yeah, we're here from McCourt's Music, coming out, letting the kids and adults, if they want to, try out all the instruments we got here. We got flutes, clarinets, trumpets, trombones, guitars, ukuleles, violins, cellos, violas, anything they want to try.
Yeah, good. Do you have any personal favorites? What do you play?
I am a trombonist and a guitarist.
Oh, yeah, trombone. That's a wild instrument there.
Yeah.
Well, it's good. You got to start the kids young, you know?
Yeah, get it while they're excited to play music.
Yeah. Now we'll see. We'll scope out some of these little kids here. All right, what's your name?
McKenna.
McKenna and?
Samantha.
Samantha. All right, let's see what you got, ladies.
Behind this whole thing, Paula, great job.
Good stuff. And Paula Messner from Royal Oak, recent grad from the spring class of 2013. She carried the ball very well in that one.
She's great. Yeah, she's really great. Since then, she's worked on several music videos for her band, which we just saw play at the concert. She does a lot of cool stop motion animation, and she goes to different locations around Royal Oak and shoots outside, some inside. Her daughter's helped her out a lot too, which hopefully she'll be a future class attendee.
That happens a lot. We've got a lot of family that get together here in the classes. They find one will get in there, get their foot in the door, and then they'll bring the rest in eventually.
Yeah, that's right. We're a TV station, but almost all of the students come through word of mouth, other recommendations from other students. You know, when someone takes a class, a lot of times they want to have their friends be able to help them out on their shoots, so they'll end up taking the class as well. It's cool to see.
One of the things I found in Paula's video, and really all of them, is how they involved the community. You know, Paula's shoot took place in a public venue, but you had all those people, all those families, kids, you know, music bands, and they're all together and brought together in this one visual package known as television that goes out on CMN. And it's really neat. And in Eunice's case, she involved Beaumont Hospital and experts there, and sharing information and education to people who would watch.
Yeah.
And Ernie's show is educational every time. So it's really something that involves a lot of people.
Yeah, absolutely. It's neat to see. It's interesting to have that avenue to let other people know in the community what you're doing, because otherwise, you know, you might be working on a project or having a get together and other people may never know about it. But when you put it together into a TV show helps you connect with people.
Absolutely. Well, from our perspective, it's a totally invaluable service. But of course, we're kind of biased. But right. Production Certification Series runs about 3 times a year here at CMN, usually toward the beginning of the year in January, then again in April, and then after Labor Day. So if you're at all interested in producing television, this is the place to come to. Look at the information on our website. It gives you more than enough info to sign up, get involved, and who knows, maybe next time we'll be watching you on Producer Review. For Kevin Eckert, I'm Jay Wenko. We'll see you next time.